Welcome everyone and thank you for joining us today for today's webinar. My name is Dwayne Sion and I'm the Product Marketing Strategist for Cloud Infrastructures and Services at ShareWeb. Today our topic is all you need to know about Azure New Commerce, which will be presented by Eric Beauchamp from ShareWeb, Belen Tamayo, and Andre Ferrer from Microsoft. Just a little housekeeping before we get started. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them in the question box in your GoToWeb webinar control panel. I may bring them up during the presentation. We'll also have time for questions at the end. Today, our webinar, all you need to know about Azure New Commerce, will cover the Azure New Commerce experience, which includes key concepts, benefits, changes, and how all of this will affect you. Before we start, I wanted to let you know all about our partners who are going to be talking today. We have Eric Beauchamp, who is ShareWeb's Web Product Director for IaaS. He has extensive product management experience with cloud-based professional software and traveled across US and Europe, helping software development and network and monitoring companies. We also have Belen Tamayo. She's the Cloud Solutions Provider Program Lead at Microsoft US. Belen has worked for Microsoft for over the last 10 years in different roles, starting from Latin America with retail sales and marketing, and moving to the US to work with Surface, Microsoft 365 business groups, and most recently, the partner team. And we have Andre Ferrer from Microsoft Canada. He has over 17 years of experience in the technology market. Andre has worked with companies such as Oracle and Microsoft, and in his current role, he works closely with distribution and partner channel to enable and empower the channel to build, grow, and transform their cloud business and solution portfolio. Thank you all for being here today, and we'll start our presentation with Eric Beauchamp. The floor is yours.
All right, thank you very much, Dwayne. So pleased to be here today. Thank you everyone for joining this webinar. So, as Dwayne explained today, we'll start with looking at what are the key concepts behind the new commerce experience. This is a program that's been in public for several months already. So you may have heard about it, you may have received communications from Microsoft. So today we're lucky to have Belen and Andre with us that will be really sharing what's the philosophy and how this will change doing commerce and transacting with Azure. So after this session, we'll actually look at how this will actually change in terms of the transactional experience that you have with ShareWeb. So we'll talk about the concept of partner earned credit and admin rights. We'll talk about how order processing and invoicing will change. It's minor changes, but it's good for you to know how those workflows will evolve. And we'll also talk about when it will be available, what will be the transition. And then we'll have 10 minutes for Q&As for your questions from this webinar. All right, so just to get started, the three main pillars or axes of the new commerce initiative by Microsoft is really an alignment of the sales motion between channels. So as you're aware, working with ShareWeb, you're in the CSP channel, but the EA and direct channels already have their own offers. So it's really about aligning this, and Belen will explain in details what this is. So as part of this, it's also to make the buying experience more consistent across those channels, simpler as well, so that it's easier to create your own offerings on top of this. And then we'll be talking about the partner added value. This is what the partner earned credit will be about. So we'll share some examples and talk about this in details a bit later. So let's get started with Belen, who's really responsible for this program and knows it in and out. So floor is yours.
Good afternoon, everybody. And thanks again for joining us today to learn more about Microsoft's new commerce experience, starting with Azure Commercial. So providing a quick summary as an introduction to this section, new commerce is all about Microsoft's response to the significant global change since we first introduced licensing programs 30 plus years ago. It is also a response to customers and you guys demanding, expecting more from Microsoft, and therefore the need that we have on improving the buying and selling experience. And third, it is all about customer choice, and we will talk about these three specific things in this section of the presentation. So with that, let's start with the main changes that have been happening over the last many years and our view of what is happening right now. I think I do have control to move the slides. Perfect, thank you. You may be very familiar with this, like, you know, like organizations now are eager to digitally transform their business. This is just a couple of the quotes that we were using on reinforcing our need to evolve new commerce experience for everybody, partners, customers, for ourselves as well. There are many different Forrester studies about like what is the situation on the market, and you guys know it by heart. You are day in and day out working with partners that are in and you see how the business leaders are changing and who is definitely influencing the business decisions. We know that 68% of business buyers are doing their own research. They're open to buy through self-serve. They know exactly what they want, and they look for partners in a different way. They're looking for partners in the sense of the need of a specialization, yeah, the real need of supporting the customers in their digital transformation. In a nutshell, Microsoft is upgrading the commerce model to improve, as mentioned before, the buying and selling experience for our customers. The new commerce experience is about improving this way in different way, through different filters. Across the board, whether the customer comes to buy our products through partners or directly through our sales force, we want to ensure that the experience is consistent and satisfying for the customers. We will land this in a bit, but basically the first key is simplification, both from the partner's point of view through one Microsoft partner agreement versus the five different agreements that we currently have, but from the customer side also through one Microsoft customer agreement. This Microsoft customer agreement is new in the CSP or the partner-led in the our view of Microsoft channels, but it was already launched in the field assisted or Microsoft-led back in February, March, and it's also been launched in self-service like Azure.com early June, July, early in this fiscal year. Now the same Microsoft customer agreement is coming to the partner-led or CSP. This is one Microsoft agreement that customers sign regardless of the way that they want to buy. Expanding the portfolio, moving from the right to the left-hand side, the new commerce platform will have a single offer catalog, first and third-party offers available for partners to build bundles and to improve the value-added services, which is key in the CSP program. I mentioned before the simplified agreement, and through the bundling and creation of these specific value-added services, the intention is to provide you the tools for attracting new customers here. Many times I have the question, Microsoft's speakers have the question about what is the difference between Microsoft channels. So let me drive you to the next slide to give you like our general view of when customers should buy or should choose in each of the channels, and give you like a quick explanation of how we see the channels. Here, this is a CSP presentation. We value the partners as supporting the value-added services like project services, managed services, package IP, for example. The key on the partner-led or CSP is the partners are managing the end-to-end relationship. So if a customer wants end-to-end support from the different partners, then this is the channel that they should select. As mentioned before, self-service is when customers are already buying through Azure.com. They want a VM, they want something specific, something simple. They do not need any of the value-added services that partners are providing, or they do not have any complex transaction as we will see in the field-led or the Microsoft-led. Field-led is basically Microsoft sellers, which are helping the customers on more complex needs, specific contract requirements, the famous enterprise agreements. And I started this presentation mentioning that Microsoft is transforming its commerce experience, starting with Azure Commercial. Right now, all these experience, all these upgrades are available for Azure Commercial. In the future, 2020 plus, Microsoft is learning about this first step on Azure Commercial to bring all the other products, all the other clouds, and all the other audiences like Microsoft 365, Dynamics 365, and eventually we'll have public sector, education, all joining this new commerce platform, all being guided by this view of three channels, one a Microsoft customer agreement, one Microsoft partner agreement. But by now, as I mentioned before, this is all about Azure Commercial. So if we move to the next slide, let me recap a little bit on what it is very important for this call, which is Microsoft partners, which have happened in the past, signed many different agreements, as I mentioned before. Now they're signing one, the Microsoft Partner Agreement. Again, the vision of simplification. This is fully digital. I hope you have already signed. You can find it in Partner Center to review and accept. We'll talk about a little bit more about the dates in the next slides. But the idea is that this is fully digital, evergreen. We will be upgrading the offers, but we don't need to start signing different agreements depending on what type of partner you are. And especially for indirect resellers working with ShareWeb, this is the first time there is this Microsoft commitment with the indirect resellers and support on a legal basis, which is the Microsoft Partner Agreement. Now, for the cloud solution provider, as you have been working and experiencing in the past, the key is the value-added services. As mentioned before, and just to name a few, projects like creating custom applications, managing the customer's Office 365 tenants and Azure. Again, this is CSP across the three transactional channels. This is core to the cloud solutions provider program. Creating packaged IP, creating SaaS applications, vertical markets, all the expertise that you have. Definitely in this cloud world, and not applicable for CSP, but in the other channels, the value is not coming from transactions. It has never been there. Partners' revenue in e-commerce and in what is coming in the future and right now for Azure Commercial is coming from adding value. And you have heard this in many different presentations and the efforts that Microsoft has been doing and Azure would have been doing in the past. But to put this in a different perspective, let me bring you up to the latest Forrester study about how you are providing opportunities for your customers to really find their digital transformation and how this is the largest opportunity by providing value that will be helping you to increase the return on investment. Organizations are leveraging you in their cloud journey. Most of the customers have a digital transformation agenda. They're just looking for the right partners and how they will play a critical role working with their IT or being, in some cases, the IT department of these organizations. So I'm not going to go in detail. You have the Forrester study link here. Take some time to review how the margins are moving across the value-added opportunities to keep building on the services that you're providing to the customers. The cloud app only, this is something that customers are buying more and more in self-service, not even in Microsoft-led directly. So being able to provide the cloud app and being able to provide migration and all the support that you guys are being specialized for, that is key in newcomers for Microsoft, starting with Azure Commercial and moving into the next clouds in the future. In order for you to be ready for this new commerce experience, we have summarized this in three things that partners should be ready, and this is applicable for 100% of the partners. As mentioned before, there are specific dates that we need to follow. Number one is the review and acceptance of the Microsoft Partner Agreement. Again, this view of simplification. We are moving, we're removing five existing either agreements or tiers or US government contracts. Now we will have one Microsoft Partner Agreement, again, a fully digital and evergreen. This Microsoft Partner Agreement is available in Partner Center. Our percentage, at least in the US, of acceptance is really high. So partners are attending the office hours, are counting on the resources, and they're signing, reviewing, and accepting the Microsoft Partner Agreement. This is mandatory by January 31st. Partners that have not accepted yet the Microsoft Partner Agreement will have challenges because they won't be able to continue transacting in CSP. If your partner is one step behind and need the process of having Partner Center, please let ShareWeb know. Let us know how we can help, because it is like a two-step process, having access to Partner Center so you can review and accept the Microsoft Partner Agreement. Number two, we don't have the specifics here. We have done many partner office hours. We had one at 9 a.m. this morning, but it's about the mandatory security terms in CSP, specifically about requesting the partners for this for the security of your platforms, for the security of your customers, to enable multi-factor authentication. This is the one that applies for all the ShareWeb indirect resellers. If you have any question, again, please let us know. And the third one is the confirmation of acceptance of the Microsoft customer agreement on behalf of the customers. Now, if you remember the graph of Microsoft Commerce on the right-hand side, there were the customers and only one agreement, which is called the Microsoft customer agreement across the three transactional channels. You will say, well, we recently launched, it was not even 2 years that we had the Microsoft Cloud agreement. That was a Microsoft Cloud agreement, was an upgrade of the agreements we had in the past for CSP, but now that's why this needs to be related to newcomers, because the Microsoft Cloud agreement is gonna be, we were gonna remove it and being replaced by the Microsoft customer agreement. As mentioned before, simplified for the digital, one consistent agreement that customers sign. It's evergreen, so this is available and useful for the customers across the three transactional channels. I mentioned before, newcomers is about Azure Commercial, but in the case of the MCA, the Microsoft Customer Agreement, in CSP, it applies to 100% of the partners for 100% of the offers. There's no other agreement that you will be able to make the attestation process on behalf of your customers as partners when they are buying through the CSP program. Again, the transition period ends in January 31st. After these days, all customers might only have the option to follow the attestation process, accept the Microsoft customer agreement. And there are a lot of resources here for your support. Let me go to the next slide before I give the floor to Eric. So with that being said, and with the three key actions happening in the background for us, we're ready now to discuss the new commerce experience in CSP, specifically for Azure. This was launched in November 1, and it is again related to our view of transforming commerce at the core of Microsoft. We have heard from you the need to providing you know that you need to provide value-added services. Microsoft needs to make it simpler and flexible for you to build bundles and build solutions based on one single offer catalog, which was one of the big requests. That, from the partner's point of view, also the better tools to manage, optimize cost, having the same features across the transactional channels. A clear example is the Azure Cost Management that was launched in Microsoft Direct Motion back in February, March. And it was impossible to be launched in the current CSP platform, but it's available now in the new Azure offer. For the customers, you can see it here. They also needed like this consistent management experience, the same pricing, the same offers. And you will see in the next slide that the response to both the customer and the partner's request is what is bringing the new Azure commerce experience to life. So these are like the four key narratives and the four key value about the new Azure experience. Eric will light this up one by one on what it means for ShareWeb indirect resellers. But basically it's alignment of Azure across all motions, as mentioned before. It's providing the same features launched at the same time through the three transactional channels. We will be providing transition tools. Actually, they are ready as the offer was launching November 1 that will help you moving customers. But again, Eric will bring back the reality of this and how it will work for ShareWeb and the ecosystem of partners. Management tools, as mentioned before, Azure Cost Management has had like greatest reviews from customers using that, and it was a lack of feature in Azure through the current CSP platform. You know, the process of allowing the customers to have their own budget, optimization and insight tools. We call out Azure Lighthouse, not because this is particular to the new Azure experience. Azure Lighthouse was launching in July. That one is applicable for CSP, as we call it legacy, the current Azure in CSP, and the new Azure experience. But it's really important because this will allow you to manage across different customer tenants and give you different role-based access on this. So, and in addition, everything that you have done in Azure Lighthouse in the past, when you transition into the new commerce experience, it will be inherited and will pass through the customer tenant. Finally, partner governments based on what we're calling partner earned credit. There's a lot of conversation. I'll stay here for any questions if it comes on admin access on behalf of. I know this is a topic that a lot of partners are interested, but Eric will cover this as well. So with that, Duane, do you want me to, should we take questions right now or we pass with Eric and wait for the questions at the end of the presentation?
No, we can wait. We can let Eric go and we'll do the questions at the end. Thanks.
Perfect. So Eric, you can take it over.
All right, great. Thank you very much, Belen. So now we'll look at some of the items that you will have access to and that will change in your experience with Azure. So the first one is the introduction of a new entity called the Azure plan. So right now, when you transact on Azure, you're working with an Azure subscription. And typically, pretty much all organizations or tenants have a single Azure sub. So the plan here, what it does is it will let you create multiple subs for your same customer or tenant. And the goal here is for especially larger organizations where if you want to build them separately and manage costs separately, let's say you have an engineering department and you have workloads for them that are very different from sales and marketing, this will let you really set up resources at two different levels. So again, to help you with managing and tracking your costs. So on that same topic, the new tool that is coming for CSPs is called Azure Cost Management. So we see just a sample here. So basically, this is a view that lets you see different reports that you can look based on the desired period, resources, resource groups. You can set basic budgets to get alerts if you go over your thresholds that you define. So this is a tool that's been requested significantly, and it was available in the EA channel for several months, or if not years. And that's an example of the alignment of channels where a tool is now available on all channels. So we will have a detailed information on how this will work in the future. Okay, so next slide. So the next concept is the partner earned credit that we just talked about. So the way this works is it's really to see that currently every CSP and every MSP transacting Azure has what we call a resale margin off the retail price. So that margin in essence stays the same, but it becomes conditional on having admin rights on the Azure resources that are in a subscription. So that's the application of the concept of bringing value as a partner instead of purely being transactional. So it means that you need to have admin rights on those items. If you don't have admin rights, it means that your end customer is basically almost on their own. So in that case, that credit equivalent to the resale margin would not be provided for those items. So if we look at this a bit more in detail, so the way it works, it's really at the granular level of the resource itself and on a daily basis. So basically Microsoft will look at, let's say you have a VM and a disk, it will look at each one every day. And if the admin rights are present, then you're fine. The credit will be granted for those items. So business as usual, just like now. Now, in a case where the rights have been removed on that resource, then in that case, the price paid by both ShareWeb and you as a MSP is the retail price for that item on that day. So when we look at this, it's a significant change. But in reality, when we look at stats based on what the workloads are today, how things are configured, it's I think a quarter of 1% of organizations transacting with ShareWeb that would have some admin rights removed. So this is something, the reason why it's so low, it's because those rights are there by default. So every time you create a tenant, an Azure tenant through ShareWeb, you have the admin rights and they will be maintained as we transition to this new commerce. So it means that explicitly someone, your end customer, would have to request to remove those admin rights so that in that case, you wouldn't get the credit. But because of this, because it's just really an edge case, for now, we see that you know the way it works with your Azure tier discount should be the same for the vast majority of the organizations. Now, we will issue reports as well to help you if we detect that in some cases you are missing the admin rights. You will be notified of this so you can correct the situation for that. All right, next topic is about how to order Azure with newcomers. So if you're transacting Azure already, you know that the way to do it is to use this offer in the Cumulus Partner store. So it's called Azure Pay As You Go. So we are defining the solution now, but most likely will be a new offer that will be called Azure Plan, and it will be the same provisioning process. So no difference there, same speed, same requirements. So really not different at that front, on that front. Now, in terms of the invoicing, so the invoicing itself, there is no change on your current billing cycle. Let's say you're being invoiced on the 10th of each month, so no difference there. The Azure tier discount, maybe we'll just relabel it, but in terms of the margin you have right now, doesn't change by going to newcomers. Admin rights, we just talked about it. So in the event that some resources you do not have them, we'll let you know. And we will also list the retail price adjustments, since in that case, both you and ShareWeb would be paying retail to Microsoft for that. Now, for Canadian customers, one change and also other countries is, since now there will be a single price list in US dollars. So the way this will work is that every month, Microsoft will be using a published exchange rate to convert those US the prices into the different currencies. So in Canada, you would get your invoice still in Canadian dollars like today, no change, but the price may vary slightly based on the exchange rate. And here what we'll do, we will for sure show those amounts on the invoice so you can see that it's the Microsoft published rates that have been used for your invoice. And on that front, just to talk about how this works and why is Microsoft going to the single USD price list, we have Andre from Microsoft Canada who will provide some details about this change here. So Andre, if you can take it over, please.
Yeah, absolutely, Eric, and thanks, thanks Eric, and thanks Belen for the great content. Yeah, so it's great because this is a quick topic. It will take not more than 5 minutes about pricing FX. We know how important it is, and it's very, very important for the Canadian partners. But I think everything we saw so far, it's important for all the partners in the webinar, because all the changes that Microsoft is promoting is to really help our partners on building more solid practices around our Azure platform, right? And these changes comes from unifying agreements, unifying platforms, right? And unifying pricing. So we can give a better experience for our end customers, right? But also to make our MSPs and our partners more valuable for our customers, right? The way you control the cost, the way you can predict the cost, and also the way you build your customers. So regarding the price and FX, I think Eric covered 80% of the content. But we now, for the new Azure platform, Microsoft now having a standard price US dollars globally, right? It means that, and one of the reasons we are doing this is to give better transparency and also flexibility for our end customers, right? We know that our customers are going globally and they're going digitally, right? And having different prices in different countries were causing to our ecosystem some distractions that we should not be worried about it. So basically, Microsoft saying for now on there is one global US price, and every month, as Eric mentioned, we're gonna have 16, and this is the next slide, we're gonna have 16 exchange rates. Let me shift to this next slide here. We're gonna have 16 supported currencies worldwide, and don't worry about it, because ShareWeb will be the partner, as Eric explained it, getting the price in USD, make sure that we are applying the Canadian dollars, and publish to you a price in local currency, right? But as Eric mentioned, we're going to probably have a fluctuation for probably a few dollars up, a few dollars down, depends on how the exchange rate behaves on that specifically month. But we're going to make sure that there is no partners or any other player on the other side of the world with a better Azure price just because they're buying from a country A or country B. Now we are giving full transparency for the entire ecosystem around the world that the Azure price is the same, is the same one for every customer, despite on where he's consuming the Azure. The way The way it's gonna happen, and again, this is more for Share Web because they're gonna be sending you the local price, but we're gonna have tons of writers publishing on the first day of each calendar month an exchange rate, and Share Web will be the one translating this new price list for all of you in the beginning of the month. It's important to say that this is affects only the new consumption of Azure that will come from the new commerce platform. Everything that we have on our current Azure for the partners that are doing Azure already on our current platform, all these changes doesn't affect you. It's gonna affect you, and if one day, as Belen explained, you decided to move from the old platform from the current platform to the new platform. So let's last but not least, this is a little bit on how it's gonna work, and again, it's more for Share Web than for all the partners, but everything that you're gonna consume, we're gonna publish. For example, the example here is about January. On the first day of the month, the January FX rate goes into effect. So every consumption that we're gonna have on a specific calendar month, you're gonna be using this exchange rate. Same thing valid for the reserved instance. If you decided to buy a reserved instance for a specific customer, right, we're gonna guarantee that the exchange rate that we're gonna be using is the one that was published for January, right? On the beginning of February, we're gonna release the new February FX rate based on Thomson Reuters report. ShareWeb is gonna get this, publish the new list for you with some adjustments on the FX rate. And then after I think few days on the new month of February, we're gonna be invoicing ShareWeb. But again, this is more to show you transparency that this is what we are doing with ShareWeb. I know ShareWeb has an optimization on how they bill each partner and how the cycle works for each partner. So keep working with ShareWeb to understand exactly when your voice is coming. We are just showing transparency that what we are doing in terms of FX how this change is gonna help all of us on having a normalized price around the world in terms of Azure consumption. That's it on my side.
Great, thank you, Andrea. It's great to see the explanation here for the exchange rate. So moving on to the next topic. So what are the next steps for accessing Azure New Commerce? So first of all, as we saw, as Belen explained, so you have to sign the Microsoft Partner Agreement. You also have to sign the Microsoft Customer Agreement on behalf of your customers. It's something that the ShareWeb Online store allows you to do now already. And in terms of the automated order processing for transacting on newcomers, so our development team at ShareWeb is currently really busy working on this. It is a large project using new APIs, so there's a lot of changes in the code and testing to be done. So we will come back to you shortly with our ETA for this. Our goal is to make it as early as we can in 2020, but we don't have specific availability date yet. So you'll be informed of this. And until then, you just continue to buy, provision the current Azure platform as you do. So the Azure Pay as you go offer in the online store remains available. And if should you have questions about newcomers, right away, so you can contact your account manager. So for this, we can provide the answer your questions and more information. In terms of the transition, so how this will work, so there's going to be a migration workflow, but it has absolutely no impact on your side. There's nothing you will have to do beyond accepting the MPA, MCA. So what we'll do is we'll notify you beforehand. So you'll receive a communication letting you know that, okay, we plan to migrate you from Azure Legacy to newcomers within that time frame. And there's no downtime on their workloads. There's no limitation on accessing the items because it's really fast. It's more a transition from the admin side that is happening from the partner center. So once a customer is transitioned to Azure plan, then you can no longer purchase items on the older platform. So it will really be the transition is let's say that you have, as a partner, you have five orgs. What we'll do in our planning, try to migrate your five orgs at the same time. So you're on the new platform from that point. So the legacy Azure platform itself, so the one that is the current one that you use, is expected to still be available until the last quarter of 2020. So it gives time to change and adapt. But at the same time, from a shareware perspective, as soon as we can provide you access, we will, since you will benefit from those new tools that we just saw. So in a nutshell, that's the transition workflow. So there's plenty of resources available that Microsoft published. You will get a copy of this, including that link where if you're interested in learning more about some of the topics we discussed today from a Microsoft standpoint, so you'll be able to look at this. One of the documents, the L200 here, quite detailed, but very a good overview of all the changes from newcomers that you can expect here. So it's now 2:40, so we will actually transition to the Q&A section. Dwayne, if it's okay with you?
Yep, sure, absolutely. So first of all, I just want to thank everyone. You know, we truly appreciate you guys being here. And I'm just going to take a look and see what questions that we have right here. There was something that you mentioned, Eric, in earlier, the AOBO. Can you go into a little bit detail of what that means?
Yeah, so that's the acronym for administered on behalf of. So when we talk about admin rights, but it's a topic that it's actually Belen could provide more information, better information than me on this. There's the RBAC, the role-based access control as well. So there's quite a long list of permissions that qualify so that you can earn the partner earned credit. So it's not one single item. And you can correct me on this, Belen, maybe?
Yes, no, absolutely. You're right. So first, like all the CSP partners get admin access on behalf of as soon as you guys create a plan for a customer. You guys are assigned the privilege of admin rights in Azure, which is basically the core of the partner earn credit or the incentives. This is just a subscription of the owner's right through the admin, as mentioned before, the AOBO, the admin on behalf of. This is something that you have been granting and you have been using for all the years that you've been working with CSP. There's no difference there. Now, if a customer wants and asks you to be part, so they want to reduce the level of access, for example, there are issues with health or some legal companies or name it, there's a whole list of role-based access options that you can still have access and still be granted different levels of access. So I shared with the team, and they maybe can share with you guys all their RBAC options that you have. And that's when I made the presentation. Azure Lighthouse is extremely important because Azure Lighthouse also provides you different access to the customer tenants, depending on what is the value added that you're providing to the customer. I hope that helps in answering this question.
Perfect. We have another question from Richard. So can we opt to be billed in US instead of Canadian to mitigate our FX, you know, the exchange risk?
Okay, I'll take it. That's Eric. So yes, it's possible to do this if you're transacting. I believe it's your organizations would have to be US, or you could create a second account in our online store. But this I need to double check and verify with the dev team, because we have customers that actually have organizations in both countries. So what they do, they have two accounts in the Cumulus ShareWeb. But I'm not sure that you have the option to be straight in USD. So to be clarified, we'll write it down and come back to you on this.
Yeah, and Eric, it's Andre. Just a comment here to just to emphasize this. This would not affect U.S. customers / ShareWeb U.S. partners, right? So if you're built on U.S. today, there is no change. It's just for the ones on the customers and / the partners that are in Canada, right? Just to make this sure that ShareWeb is not changing. ShareWeb is not changing the billing for U.S. partners and with the U.S. customers, right?
Correct. Yeah.
Cool. All right, we got another question from Jesse. Will the monthly payment model for reserved instances be available in this new system?
Okay, Eric here. So yes, and it's actually already available. So you can contact your account manager. So the monthly reserved instances were introduced late September by Microsoft. So we can process them even with the current platform. So you can contact your account manager. Yeah.
Awesome, great. If anybody has any other questions, you can always type it into the question box. I have another question here. What happens if a customer removes partner admin access?
Okay, so again, to explain the process, so let's say that they remove it for just one VM and a disk, so two resources. So the Microsoft system will be looking every day on these two resources, and it will say on that date, there was no admin rights, and the next day, no admin rights. So let's say you end up with, it's been 15 days in the month times two resources. So for these two resources, you will be paying the full retail price because Microsoft in that case is not giving back the partner earned credit. Because the partner earned credit is a new line item that will appear on the invoice and showing your savings from retail. So basically it works just like now with your Azure tier discount that you have. It's just that it becomes conditional on those admin rights.
Eric, in order for any customer to remove the admin access on behalf of, they need to ask the partners to grant them access to the tenant. So that is core. When this happens, this is a flag for the partners to start the conversation of the customer to understand what is the intention of being added into the tenant. Because again, CSP is an end-to-end solution through the partner. The customer is trusting the CSP partner to manage and build on their support. But even in the absence, let's say they ask you to be part of the customer to be part of the tenant, they're removing the AOBO. Even in the absence of AOBO as it stands, if the partner is using some like Azure Lighthouse or they still have any basic guest access through the role-based access, they can still have the permissions being still applicable for the partner earned credits. A key thing is that the CSP for Azure, how you guys know right now versus how it is defining newcomers, newcomers platform has the telemetry, as Eric mentioned before, to see on a daily basis the support that the partners are providing to the customers. That's why the role-based access and list is really long, even like support for a customer request, or you can see it there when it's posted and it's actually posted in the documents before. So there are many different roles that the partner can have in the customer tenant to maintain their partner and credit.
Yes, and as we get closer to the availability, we will publish a document with the list of those roles so that's really clear so that everyone understands what those roles are in terms of for the partner earned credit. Yeah.
I got another question from Jensen. The only Azure offering I see is pay-as-you-go, but it's grayed out. Will there be new Azure options available soon?
Yes, so the reason it's grayed out is that currently to provision Azure, there needs to be a discussion with your account rep just to initially create the business and set it up together. And this is something that was put in place as a mechanism for security because when it was freely available, even though a credit card is required, we saw some cases where there was a bit of abuse on this. So it was really in terms of making the processing secure. This being said, with the new commerce platform, we'll see what mechanisms are in place and eventually we could make it self-provisioning, especially for partners that already have history of transacting Azure, which is different from a completely new partner joining. Yeah.
Perfect. If anyone has any other questions, you can ask. I'll wait a couple of seconds to see if there's any more. Okay, no, we don't have any more, but I'll just leave with one. So the big question is, why is Microsoft making all these enhancements?
I can take that one. Basically, as I mentioned in my section, there's like significant change. Partners need help, and we are here to support you do and spend the time and resources on what you need to do to go with your customer and finding and supporting their journey towards digital transformation. We were not born in the cloud. We are basically at a point that we have more than 26 different programs named EA, MPSA, Open. We totally understand the need of simplifying the buying and selling experience with Microsoft and with our partners at ShareWeb. So this is our north, and more things are coming. This is one of the most important changes that the company has been going through, and it's not a change that will take 3 or 6 months. It's not a program. It is a multi-year journey that is starting with Azure. Actually, things like reserve instances were made on the new platform. It is starting with Azure Commercial, but eventually, as mentioned before, the other clouds and the other audiences will come to one full rich commerce platform that will be the only platform for all the products, the cloud products, cloud solutions that we sell. And through the partner-led or CSP will be the first and third party catalog for partners to create value-added services, to create bundles, to create solutions for the customers.
Awesome, that's great. Thank you very much. I don't see any more new questions coming in, so I guess we're gonna finish about maybe 5 minutes early on this one. So I just wanna thank Andre, Belin, and Eric so much for being part of this webinar. And if there are any additional questions, please always feel free to contact your account manager, and we'll be more than happy to answer any of the questions that you have. Just to let you know that this presentation will be available to everyone. So we're going to be sending out a follow-up email with a link to the presentation, and also all the links inside the presentation will be clickable as well. So you'll have access to those resources as well. And at that, I just would like to say thanks you to everyone for attending this webinar, and we'll see you again very soon.
Thank you all.
Thank you.